founded in 1892. 3 million members and supporters now nationwide. We're all about fighting for clean air, clean water, and preserving our wild and natural places. Most of our work the last few years has been focused on shutting down 250 some odd coal plants around America. Now, since the last year and a half, we are also working on the goal of getting cities ready for 100% clean energy for all, like Orlando did Tuesday. We have now 41 cities in America. Orlando was 40. One more came along a couple days later. And 141 mayors who have said that their city is going forward with clean energy for all. This is about ending the demand for fossil fuels. A lot of us have been working for a long time on cutting that supply. Fracking, offshore drilling, all that nasty stuff. If we end the demand, we can do this. Isn't it wonderful that we live at a time when we realize that we have to stop burning fossil fuels as quickly as we can, that we now have all the tools before us to figure out how to do that as quickly as we possibly can. So the plans that Chris put up here are brilliant. We are working with groups all over the state. Sierra Club has started the Clean Energy for All campaign that had a victory here in Orlando, but it is not just our campaign. League of Women Voters, Organize Florida, Kim's group in Brevard County, people all over the state are embracing this. And if you come to our workshop later this afternoon, I'll talk to you about some of the things that you can do in your community, your county, to assess where the lowest hanging fruit is so you don't go knocking on doors and beating your head against the wall when down the street there is another city that might be a better thing. We believe that local communities, city by city by city by city, will influence what happens in the state, what happens in the federal government. Since we have the people that we have in Washington and Tallahassee today, our emphasis is on action right here, right now. Thank you.
We started in 2009, we were the last PAC chartered in the state of Florida up until last week, and Winter Park National is the only government charter grant since then. Chris said he's a new father, I'm a relatively new grandfather, I didn't know that's why I was doing what I do, but now it's crystal clear that's why I do what I do. I'll be 60 in a month and a half, so my motto is 60 is the new 60. And the reason 60 is the new 60 is because we don't have much time. And we don't have much time, and I firmly believe that humans can reduce or increase by 30% whatever's good or whatever's bad overnight. So this talk, I hate to say it, Chris, but this talk about 2050 being energy independent or whatever, that's too long. And I had dinner with Mitch Berger the other night, me and my assistant Robbie Gossett, and we may know Mitch, he's a very, very heavy hitter politically. He represented Al Gore in the war, first Bush thing. And I wish this was my quote, but I'm gonna plagiarize it. He said, "I don't give a shit how many abortions there are or how many gay marriages there are, the sea's still rising." And you know, we just don't have time. He lives in Fort Lauderdale. He said that he's now in his personal financial statement valued his $3 million house at zero. He says it's okay, he's got the money, he likes living there, but it's worth nothing. So That's all I can. Oh, no, one more thing. We are a member of the Global Alliance for Banking on Values. I served on the board up until March of this year. It was a bucket list thing that I didn't know was in my bucket list. Look it up, and if you need to bank with somebody, which everybody does, bank with one of the members of the Global Alliance for Banking on Values.
I'm Aliki Moncrief. I'm the Executive Director of Florida Conservation Voters. Voters is really probably the most important word in our name. Our mission is quite simple. It is that we are here to elect conservation leaders to public office. And I think that's part of how, I think George talked about sort of what do our relative organizations bring to the table. I think that's our focal point. Many of you probably, if you know about us, you may have first learned about us in 2012. We were the campaign to pass the Water and Land Conservation Amendment in 2014, which won the 70,000 votes. And our goal with that was partly to demonstrate to the environmental community, the conservation community, that working on proactive policies and engaging politics is a clear path forward to winning for our environment. We are not issue specialists like many of the other groups and folks, so we don't view ourselves as the policy experts. We're the politics experts and the elections experts. So when it comes to thinking about what are the big things that need to happen, educating, advocating, add electing to that list. And that's something that I think we can never forget. It always has to be one of the layers that folks are thinking about.
My name is Eric Rollins. My name is Eric Collins, and I'm the chair of the Orange Soil Water Conservation District. I'm also the chair of Congressman Soto's Natural Resources Advisory Committee. I also started the Foundation for Florida Environmental Protection, and that group works hand-in-hand with Rethink Energy, and we've really made amazing strides to ban fracking in Florida. If people don't know what Soil and Water Conservation District supervisors do, we're pretty much the liaison between the general public and other elected officials. We're an elected body, we're unpaid, we're nonpartisan. But we've had really, really great success, and it's great to be a chairman in a county and a city that embraces ideals that are really, really proactive, and as Chris pointed out, just amazing. I have other supervisors I talk with throughout the state and the country, and they have to beat their heads against the wall every single day just to get the simplest things done. You know, and locally we've been able to save Constitution Green, a green space that's 1.2 acres that will be there forever. And that's because we have proactive elected officials and can see not just what's gonna happen tomorrow, but 100 years down the road. So, and I think it's really important, as many of the other panelists have said, that we really need to engage in and with our other elected officials. And if you can't get a hold of them, if they refuse to meet you, if they're against it, then you run for their seat. And so I think that's what we're, Kim and I are gonna talk about, is really getting that activism, and if it's not here, if it's not the way you like it now, then let's change it. Thanks.
Hi everyone, my name is Michelle Suarez with Organize Florida. I'm originally from Colombia, and I've been here in Central Florida for the past 17 years now. On that note of running for office, so Organize Florida, we do civic engagement, social equity. What we're really looking for is to make sure that everyone has the same equal access of resources, right? And we're looking for justice, basically. And so that looks, the way to get there looks different for different people, but our approach is going door to door, especially in marginalized communities, holding our elected officials accountable, empowering our communities to not only take action, but to get to liberation in their own terms. And as I said, I'm one of the organizers doing climate justice. We're part of several coalitions. And we have big plans, and as I said, we're empowering the community to take action, run for office, and things like that.
Good morning. My name is Mary DuBois, and I'm the one of the people who serve on the FL Sun Advisory Board. You might have heard about FL Sun. We've been kind of stirring things up here by creating solar co-ops in counties around the country. Southern Alliance was one of our very first funders. I see so many people connecting familiar faces, and Chris was our very first kickoff speaker and our very first meeting, and remains on our advisory board. We are helping bring the solar message to communities because people are interested but confused. They want to get information, but they don't want to be talking to a high-pressure installer salesperson. What we're doing is, when we host a co-op, we are finding a group of local leaders that works with the FL Sun staff. We hold community information meetings. We offer rooftop analysis. I again, people then can figure out, yeah, I'm a candidate, or I'm really not a candidate to go solar on my homeowner's roof. And then when the solar co-op people come together, they meet for one night, they select their installer based on the bids that they've received. That one installer then is going to be working with that group. The co-op member is not required to sign that contract. And there are about 30-40% of the people who do go ahead and sign that contract as the time is right and it looks like the right offer for them. But financing, it's so good that PACE is now available here in this community because that's going to help folks that might not be eligible for other loans to get a solar loan, although many people do get solar loans at First Green Bank and others in the state. So we are, so far we've had 450 people go solar through the co-ops. We've had over 2,000 people join the co-ops. We've had 12 co-ops launch so far. Next fall and next spring, we have another 8 on them that are scheduled. We are looking for community leaders to help us coordinate on the local level, and so I'd love to talk to some of you here today.
Thank you. So I'm going to open the floor up, but before I do that, I just want to say we have a table outside. I meant to mention this earlier, so if you brought literature, brochures for an organization that you'd like to share with everyone, please just put it out on the table. So let me open up the floor. Does anybody have any questions for any of our panelists? Come on, I know you do. In the back, go ahead here.
I believe it was the gentleman from Southern Alliance for Energy. So can you tell us more about the Public Service Utilities Commission? I know there's an opening recently. What is the truth about the PSUC? They're supposed to represent our interests, and I feel like it's a revolving door of fossil fuel utilities and political cronies. And how do we resist that? How do we make change there positively for our community? So I think that's the puppet master.
Let's see. Excellent question. So the Public Service Commission is sort of a nondescript agency. You may not have heard of it. I think most of the people in this room have. It's comprised of 5 commissioners, and they're generally tasked with setting rates for the state's major utilities, for setting conservation goals, efficiency goals. They're supposed to help people, customers, lower their energy use and save money on their bills, and then also to determine whether power plants are needed or are not needed. So you're right to kind of focus in on the PSC because that's where a lot of the resource decisions are being made. And when these decisions are being made, they affect everybody. They affect all the customers. They affect the municipalities in the utilities service territory. If they're trying to reach sustainability goals and their incumbent utility isn't helping them through helping their customers reduce their energy, save money on their bills, or meaningfully developing solar power, that's a challenge to a local municipality. There are a couple other things right now. I think it's too late for you to apply. There are 2 commissioners that are seeking to be reappointed, and there's currently a vacant seat. It's no secret that the PSC, the utilities, have a oversized influence in Tallahassee, especially the big ones like Florida Power and Light, to a lesser extent Duke Energy, Gulf, and TECO. The municipals, by the way, I wouldn't put them in the same boat. You're very fortunate here in Orlando to have a municipal utility. It's not owned by shareholders. Essentially, you are the shareholders of the local utility company, and they seem to be very receptive. They listen to their customers, so that's really encouraging. But a company like FPNL produces power for half the state. And in South Florida, where I live. So the process is, it's essentially a political process because the PSC commissioners are selected by a nominating committee in the legislature, and that pool of applicants is provided to the governor, who ultimately chooses who sits on that panel. The power companies provide a lot of contributions to individual candidates, political committees. They have you know, obvious or too obvious for every legislator in the Capitol. So I think I'm going to kind of go back to something that Leakey was saying, and it goes back to really, you know, politics and elections and voting. I think, you know, at the end of the day, we need to encourage, you know, we need to get out and vote and encourage our friends to vote. We need the help of Florida Conservation voters to tell us who are the good guys and who are the bad guys. You know, but ultimately, I think it's a political solution, and it's going to take all of us to change that paradigm.
Ballot box, and your friends with a ballot box, you can hold them accountable on. If they didn't nominate folks who are good on climate, then you should let them know that their seat is up for negotiation, or, you know, their job's up for, or, yeah, exactly.
Thank you.
Another question?
Hi, I'm wondering if you can address the dilemma of the renter, a non-property owner, because in the 20 years that I've successfully in most places gone off-grid and reduced my fossil fuel use, whether it was California, New York, Germany, Egypt, and now moved to Florida, where I'm teaching in Tampa, I've had to go guerrilla sustainability. I've had to install my own solar panels that I get off Amazon.com. I've had to put in my own backyard biodigesters, and there's been no systemic municipal or community incentives. In fact, there's been a lot of fear that we're going to be shut down for installing our own solar panels and putting in our own biodigesters. Can you address what Orlando might be doing for those of us who don't own property and have to do it this way because there's no rebates, there's no way to do green intertie, what we can do?
Chris, do you want this one?
Yeah, I think your point's a really important one because we have a pretty high rental population here in the city of Orlando. It's close to 50% of our population is renters. And so there's this inherent landlord-tenant complex, they call it, where there's not really an incentive for the tenant to invest because it's not their building. There's not really an incentive for the landlord to invest because they don't get the utility bill. So there's kind of this really, there's this disconnect. What we've been trying to do is educate the marketplace, primarily in the commercial and multifamily marketplace, around what's called the green lease clause for their tenants. And there's actually energy-aligned lease language that allows essentially a split incentive for both the tenant and the landlord to make an investment to lower their bill or invest in more energy-efficient technologies. So if the landlord actually makes the investment, as an example, for a short period of time, they could charge a little bit more for that rent to recoup their return. But you're going to see a net benefit in the overall cost of operations because your utility bill will go down. So the idea is to find that win-win situation where the utility drops more than what the increase in the rental payment is, and you have a win-win there. The same thing can happen with tenant investing and lowering their actual monthly rent for the landlord who's actually getting the benefit of this improvement to their overall asset value. I think so that's one way in terms of the lease language, and we've been educating a lot of realtors, building owners, building managers, that as they upgrade their you know their new tenants, that they incorporate energy lease language. There's a lot of information online. If you've recently green lease library, there's a ton of example clauses and legalese essentially that you the other thing is around the financing. I mentioned PACE. PACE is a really important tool, but it's not the only tool. There's also another nonprofit that started in St. Lucie County and just recently replicated that here to St. Petersburg. I'm really excited. It's called SELF, the Solar and Energy Loan Fund. And SELF is a really interesting model for renters because it's essentially a nonprofit 501c3, but they got creative and they went through the Department of Treasury's designation as a Community Development Finance Institution, CDFI. And a CDFI is really positioned to take very low interest capital from larger banks that are required to give to CDFIs every year through what's called Community Reinvestment Act, CRA. And the CRA gives this money primarily to CDFIs to build affordable housing. Affordable housing, the CDFIs are normally affordable housing developers and they get low income tax credits from the federal government, and they get this low interest capital, I mean, sometimes sub to some 1% on the cost of capital. And what SELF did is said, well, instead of me building affordable housing, I'm going to take this low cost of capital and mark up a little bit for my operations as a nonprofit to about a 4 to 5% interest rate, and then provide a loan to a homeowner or a renter to make improvements. And it has to be energy efficiency, water efficiency, or renewables, and then essentially find that cash flow positive scenario. So you have both a loan product, you have PACE, which is a special assessment, and then our utility agency does have some really interesting on-bill financing type efforts for renters. That program is called Efficiency Delivered, where you can get a free energy assessment and then $2,000 to make weatherization improvements. Primarily it's weatherization, but it's not a lot of money. And then you repay it on the utility bill over a two-year term. The cool thing is if you're under a $40,000 per year household income, you get 85% subsidized by OUC in the city. So you're only paying $300 of the $2,000 that we gave you. And you're paying that back again as another line item on the bill, amortized over however the term you agreed to. So there are some tools out there that we're trying to offer because we realize landlord paying complex is this group.
And then also the OUC audits for like weather stripping, they come in and they do an assessment of the rental house or whatever. As long as the landlord signs off on that, that's available as well.
This is to me and Sierra Club why it's so important to have a goal for a city. My wife says I need to lose 10 pounds. Go figure, right? If I don't set a goal, I will never do what it takes to get there. Our campaign slogan is clean energy for all. If we don't make this work for everybody, if we don't figure out how to make this work for everybody, make every home energy efficient, give everybody access to community solar or solar on the roof or whatever, we'll never get there. We lose Florida. So when a city adopts this goal, and city by city by city and city around the state adopts this goal, then they get serious. They put it in their comp plans. They do ordinances. They have policies. They do the initiatives, the innovative things that Orlando has already done here because they've been working towards this for a while. This needs to happen all over Florida. It needs to happen all over the state because we can't leave anybody out. Even if you don't care about low-income people, even if you don't care about renters because you don't know anybody that rents, we have to include everyone. It's the right thing to do, and it's how it has to work.